Ladies and gentlemen and guests, students, colleagues, sponsors who made this possible, and the university as a whole. So I would like to welcome you all. Good morning on the part of the Department of Political Economy and Statistics of this university for the second Hahn lecture, second lecture in memory of Professor Frank Hahn, who had a position here in Siena for about 10 years and passed away in 2013. We had a first lecture last year. I'll tell you a little bit more about after the welcome address of the university rector. We're very glad to have as second speaker, second in the sequence, but not in the rank, of course, Professor Eric Musken, Nobel laureate in economics, 2007, and professor of economics at Harvard. And the reason why we invited Professor Musken, besides his outstanding profile, is that he had a strong connection with Professor Hahn as well. And the same happened with last year lecturer, Professor Backhouse from Birmingham. He didn't have a personal connection, but he was coming from Birmingham. As I'll tell you later after the address by the rector, he was member of the university where Professor Hahn took his first position. So that was the connection. And this year the connection is even stronger, and we're very pleased about that. So I think I'm going to give the floor to our rector, Professor Angelo Riccaboni, for a welcome address on the part of the university, and I will reconvene sketching the figure of Professor Hahn afterwards and presenting Professor Musken before he would give a speech. So thank you very much, and Professor Riccaboni.
Good morning, everybody. I would like to thank Professor Musken for being with us today. I'm very pleased on behalf of the University of Siena to welcome him. I would like to thank Nicola Dimitri for his efforts to have with us today Professor Musken, the Department of Economics and Statistics, for organizing these Hahn lectures. I'm very pleased that Professor Musken is here with us today, not only for formal reasons, but for substantial reasons. As everybody knows, he's very concerned with the issues of inequalities and the role that human capital can give in order to overcome inequalities. And this is something that is very important for this university, for all universities, for the School of Economics and Management, for the departments of the economic and managerial area. So I think that his research work is very relevant for us, but also is very relevant in this point of our society, I would say, because unfortunately this is a country where the role of education for economic development is not considered as important as it should be. So I think that his contribution is very important, and today you have seen also the interview on one of the major Italian newspapers that you kindly gave yesterday is underscoring the relevance of education for economic development, the role of education to overcome inequalities. But also it's a very timing intervention today, because this year, as everybody knows, or should know, is a very special year, because it's the year where the Sustainable Development Goals were approved only a few weeks ago. I had the honor and the privilege to be at the General Assembly of the United Nations as a scientific delegate of an international scientific organization. So I had the privilege to listen to Obama, to the Pope, to Matteo Renzi, to all the heads of government and state to say, yes, we can make it, we can reduce inequalities, we can have a better environment, a better world for the future. If we don't make the right decisions, our children will criticize or will hate us. 193 heads of state or government said so. So we should do something. we should suffer. So that is very important, because SDGs are creating a new scenario where at least there are four major principles. The first one is that a traditional way of doing or behaving in the economic scenario was wrong. We need to do something different. The second is that we cannot take separately environmental, social, and economic sustainability. So we need to put them together, because the poorest are those who suffer more from the environmental crisis. Third, these issues relate to all countries, not only developing countries, but also developed countries. And that is the message also Professor Maskin is giving. I think that, especially in this country, there's not the awareness that education is important also for this country, not only for third world countries. And the fourth principle of SDGs is that any constituency, any stakeholder can give a contribution in order to achieve a better world, in order to achieve SDGs. So I think that I'm very pleased with the department and with the school for this meeting, for this possibility to listen to Professor Maskin, because it's really coherent with what we need today. And I just finish my short introduction just to say that we will discuss also these issues in the inauguration of the academic year on October 28, when 100 rectors and delegates from all over the world will come with us in Siena to inaugurate the 775th academic year, because we were founded in 1240. So the message that we would like to carry on, we would like to deliver, is that social, environmental, economic sustainability is important, education is important. So thanks to Professor Maskin for being with us today. Thank you.
Thank you very much to our rector for being here for this very nice address. Let me just say I'm speaking on behalf of the chair of our department, who strongly apologizes for not being here today, and I will take his function in some sense. So, as anticipated, I will now sketch briefly, because I don't want to take much of the time, the figure of Professor Hahn and why we're having this lecture, and why Professor Maskin accepted to come. It's an homage to Professor Hahn in some sense. So Professor Hahn was considered to be one of the finest theoreticians, economists, thinkers overall of the last few decades. And we really had the luck to be able to share 10 years of his life while he was here, while he was occupying a position in our department. He was actually born in 25 in Berlin, but being of Jewish origin, the family had to move to Prague first, and then to the UK in 38. And then as a young man, he actually was immediately loyal to his country and went onto the war as a young navigator on the Air Force. Then came back and completed his education, taking a PhD at the London School of Economics, where he actually met his beloved wife, Dorothy, who cannot be here because of mobility problems. He's watching us from Cambridge at the moment, having a supervisor, Nicholas Caldo, one of the leading economists at that time. And then he took his first position at Birmingham, so that's why it was meaningful for us to have a first lecture last year given by Professor Backhouse, an eminent economic historian, historian of economic thought, in fact. He gave a lecture on general equilibrium, which, in fact, was the main field of interest of Professor Hahn. So Professor Hahn stayed from 48 to 1960 in Birmingham. Then he moved for the first time to Cambridge as a lecturer, where he also joined this famous group called the Apostles, which witnessed, as I understand, among its members, people like Keynes, Wittgenstein, Clerk Maxwell, and others, enormous figures, intellectual figures. Then he left again. Then he left again Cambridge and went to LSE for the first time as professor. In where is it? In later on, I'll find the date. 67. Sorry. And had a major impact at LSE, at the London School of Economics, together with Terence Goldman, whom he highly admired, and Dennis Sagan, a renowned econometrician, to restructure the department and the PhD program. Then after LSE, went to Cambridge in 72, became professor there, stayed there until 92, when he came to Siena for his last 10 years of career. His main interest, as most of us know, were the general equilibrium, namely the market economy existence and stability, in fact, of the economic equilibrium, and the role of money in society as well, especially in that kind of theoretical construct. Sorry. But despite being a finest theoretician, he was also very much alert on policy issues. And in fact, he was a protagonist of a letter against Thatcherism at that time, who was very much, of course, a conservative way to, if you want, to interpret that. So that was a bit of an interesting thing. General equilibrium is supposed to be, you know, in some sense conservative, no, very little state should intervene. But he was criticizing that, or at least the way Thatcher was actually conducting that. And then he also took positions on the euro currency. He sort of foresaw the problems that, in fact, later on showed up to the eyes of all of us. Then he was, besides being a fantastic researcher, he was a terrific mentor. He mentored an enormous number of eminent economists, and I suppose Professor Maskin would consider to be one of those. And that's how the connection comes about. That's the second page. Professor Maskin crosses the Frank Hahn's path, so to speak, at the postdoc stage of his career. So now I want to introduce Professor Maskin, our prestigious speaker. Professor Maskin won a Nobel Prize in 2007, but in order to win a Nobel Prize, he first had to take an undergraduate degree at Harvard in mathematics, and then a PhD in applied mathematics, still at Harvard, and then he went to Cambridge as a postdoc. And the reason why he went to Cambridge, affiliating to Jesus College, was because his PhD supervisor, Ken Arrow, one of the giants of modern economy, was in very close terms with Frank Hahn, and Frank Hahn was very keen in having young and bright and super bright people there. So he went there for the first time to spend a year at Jesus College. Then he came back to the U.S. As a faculty member from 77 to 84 at MIT. Then he moved to Harvard from 85 to 2000. Then he moved to the Institute for Advanced Studies in Princeton from 2000 until 2011, coming back to Harvard after that. But during this career path, Professor Maskin came back again to Cambridge, and in fact, to Siena as well. He came to Cambridge back for the first time in 1882 at Churchill College. Correct me if I'm wrong. And in 88, St. John's College, Cambridge, and it was on that occasion that Professor Maskin came for the first time to Siena, to one of our summer schools that we were running every year for about 15 years, with tremendous people coming, and he was one of those at the Certosa di Pontignano. Now that's insofar as his professional career. But let me just now say that The Nobel Prize was awarded for contributions to the area of mechanism design, which is an area related to game theory, jointly with Professor Meyerson and Professor Hurwitz. But it was very hard for me to list down the number of contributions in other areas that Professor Maskin gave, and it was tremendous, even harder to list all the acknowledgments and prizes and honorary degrees. Let me just mention that he received 11 honorary degrees and innumerable number of prizes and acknowledgments around the world. Of course, he wrote a large number of papers, more than 100, which in economics is kind of unusual. Let me just mention that he gave contributions to contracts theory, options, industrial organization, asymmetric information, soft budget constraint, incentives, innovation, patenting, etc. To reach his most recent interest that I wasn't aware when he gave the title of the lecture, that he actually got engaged since 4 years ago, more or less, 4 or 5 years ago, with his colleague Michael Kramer from Harvard on globalization and inequality. And that's the issue and the content of today's lecture. And we're all very much looking forward to your speech. So thank you very much, Eric. I'll give you the floor in a second. I just wanted to remind to all of us that there will be a drink afterwards, because otherwise I'll forget. Open to everyone. And I needed to point out another issue, that all of this was made possible, Frank Hahn here and Professor Maskin here, by Professor Ugo Pagano, who was the main protagonist for having Frank Hahn here at that time. So I think I've done. Now the floor is to Professor Eric Maskin. Thank you very much, Eric.
Thank you so much. I can't tell you how pleased I am to be here on this occasion. Not only was Frank Hahn a good friend, a longtime friend, but he had a tremendous impact on my career. And I vividly remember the very first time I saw him. I was doing my PhD at Harvard with Ken Arrow, as Nicola mentioned, an old friend of Frank's. Ken invited Frank to Harvard to give a few lectures, and I wanted to make sure that I heard them all, so I was there at the first lecture. Frank Hahn comes out and says, "Good afternoon, I'm Frank Hahn from the University of Cambridge, where I spend most of my time keeping away from Joan Robinson and Richard Kahn." Well, a few days later, at Ken's encouragement, I got up the courage to go see Frank in his office to introduce myself and tell him a bit about my work, and he listened. And when I was finished, he said to me, "You're very badly trained, aren't you?" Well, I suppose that should be expected from someone attending a provincial university. Well, this was rather off-putting, as you might expect. But then he went on to ask, "Would you like to get a proper education? You must come to the center of civilization," by which he meant Cambridge. And so I did. He fixed up a postdoctoral research fellowship for me at Jesus College in Cambridge, and I spent an unforgettable year there. Actually, Frank was quite amused that a good Jewish boy from New Jersey could be a fellow of a place called Jesus College. And whenever he run across me, he'd cross himself and say, "May Jesus bless you, my son." Well, during that year, I got to be good friends with both Frank and his wife, Dorothy. They had me over to their house all the time for parties, other events. And these were always lively occasions. Frank was, you're probably getting the impression that Frank was quite a charismatic and charming figure. But he had the disconcerting habits at these parties of forgetting my name when he would introduce me. So he started introducing me as Cabbage. He'd say, "Meet Cabbage." And this habit, unfortunately, carried over to other occasions. So one time he was chairing the weekly economics seminar, and I was the speaker, and so Frank began the seminar by saying, and now we'll hear from Cabbage. But the most remarkable thing that Frank did for me that year was to read all my papers and discuss them with me, almost line for line. Even though he plainly didn't care for some of the topics I was working on, he'd say, "Game theory, I don't think a gentleman would behave strategically." But despite his skepticism, he usually was able to treat my papers reasonably seriously, and he would give me excellent comments. There was one occasion where he just couldn't help himself. He said, My dear boy, you must not waste the flower of your youth on this nonsense." Well, I miss him. But I thought of him when deciding what to speak on this morning. Frank's own work tended to be quite abstract most of the time. He was very much a theorist, and I'm a theorist. But he said that every theorist has an obligation to make contact with reality and to think about some of the big issues of the day. And so although I know that Frank would disapprove of the theory I'm about to tell you about, he'd find much to criticize. I think he would approve of the fact that I will be speaking on the connection between globalization and inequality in developing economies. So, let me introduce that theme. I don't have to tell you that over the last 20 or 25 years, there's been an enormous increase in globalization. And by that I mean there has been a remarkable increase in international trade of goods and services across countries. But I also mean, and this is a point that I want to emphasize later on, that there has been more international production. The production process itself has been internationalized. It's really the second point that will play the largest role in the theory I want to offer today. The reasons for this increase in globalization are many. There's been a decline in transport costs, certainly. Maybe even more important, there's been a decline in communication costs. It's possible to be in touch and coordinate with people on the other side of the world for practically zero cost. And of course, there's been a continual removal of trade barriers. reduction of tariffs, new trade agreements. The United States is just in the process now of arranging a new trade agreement with Pacific Rim countries. Globalization has had many proponents, and these proponents have made many promises on its behalf. One of those promises is that prosperity will be brought to emerging economies, to developing economies. Well, in fact, I think it's fair to say that this promise has been delivered on to a remarkable extent, that there are a great many developing economies, and China and India are only the most prominent examples, the most spectacular examples. There are a great many developing countries whose GDPs have increased very considerably thanks to their ability to exploit international markets, to plug themselves into world trade. But there's another promise that has been made on behalf of globalization, and that's to reduce the gap between the rich and the poor, the haves and the have-nots, in emerging economies. And in this case, the record is not so good. And in fact, inequality within many emerging economies has actually increased. And once again, China and India are the most prominent examples. If you look at what's happened to the Gini coefficients in China and India, you see that they are becoming more unequal. Well, inequality is a big topic these days. You have only to pick up the newspaper to see that politicians are talking about it more and more. In this part of the world, most of the discussion has been about growing inequality in rich countries, European countries, the US, Japan. But in fact, what I'd like to emphasize today is increased inequality in developing countries. And you might ask, well, why should we care about reducing inequality? Perhaps I don't have to persuade you that it's an important issue, but let me just mention there are, I think, three important reasons why reducing inequality matters. First, there's a moral argument. There's the idea that we're all human beings, and it's offensive from an ethical standpoint to have vast discrepancies in the way that we're treated, particularly when those discrepancies arise from such arbitrary factors as which country you happen to be born in or who your parents happen to be. But even if you don't accept that egalitarian argument, there's the point that particularly in developing countries, there's a close connection between reducing inequality and reducing poverty. If you reduce the gap between rich and poor, you're probably bringing those poor people out of poverty. And even if you don't care about inequality per se, you may care about eliminating poverty. So that's the second point. And the third point is a more practical one. Even if you don't care about inequality or poverty, you might care about stability. But there's a well-known correlation between political and social instability and inequality in income. That is, countries which have very wide discrepancies in income also tend to have more disruptions socially and politically. And so just from the standpoint of keeping the social and political fabric together, you might want to do something about inequality. But we now have to ask, and this is a theoretical question, should we be surprised that inequality in developing countries has been rising as a result of globalization? Well, there, interestingly, the answer is yes, because it contradicts the theory of comparative advantage, which is probably the most venerated theory we have for understanding international trade patterns. It's a very successful theory. Goes back over 200 years to David Ricardo, and has historically done a great job in helping us understand international trade. I'll come back to this point in a few minutes. But what I want to emphasize now is that the theory of comparative advantage actually predicts that free trade should reduce inequality in emerging economies, which is just the opposite of what has happened recently. Now why does it make this prediction? Let's take a few minutes to review what the theory of comparative advantage says. According to the theory, the important difference between countries when it comes to trade is their differences in the factors of production, the inputs into the production process. So the reason that countries trade with one another is that they differ in factors of production. So some countries have a lot of land, other countries have a lot of skilled labor, some have a lot of natural resources. Those are the differences that help explain why trade is so important. Now, because I'm concerned with income, I want to concentrate on labor as the input into the production process. Let's imagine that there are two kinds of labor. There's high-skilled labor, workers who have a lot of training, a lot of education, and low-skilled labor, workers who don't have as much training and education. And I want to compare a rich country with a developing country, an emerging country. Now, the rich country is rich because it has a higher proportion of high-skill workers. That ultimately, that's why countries are rich, because of the human capital of their workers. Because the rich country has a higher proportion of high-skilled workers, it has a comparative advantage in producing goods that require a lot of high-skilled workers. So computer software is an example of something that a rich country might have a comparative advantage in producing. An emerging economy has a comparative advantage in producing goods where skill doesn't matter so much, and agricultural goods often fall into this category. Rice might be an example. So to understand how globalization affects production and how it affects inequality, let's do a thought experiment. Let's look at production before globalization, that is, before the rich country and the poor country can trade with one another, and we'll look at production after globalization, after the two countries can trade, and we'll compare. Any difference between the two must be attributable to globalization. So before globalization, before the two countries can trade, if consumers in the rich country want to have both software and rice, companies in the rich country have to produce both software and rice. And the same is true in the developing country. There will have to be both software production and rice production in the poor country in order for consumers to have both software and rice. But there's a sense in which producing software in the emerging economy is inefficient. It's making inefficient use of that country's labor force. The labor force is better suited to producing rice, and so there's a sense in which low-skill workers in the developing country are actually hurt by a diversion from rice to software production. Why? Because these workers are not needed much by software. They are needed a lot for rice, and so the extent to which the country is producing software rather than rice means a reduction in demand for low-skill labor. And that means there's a downward pressure on low-skill wages. Just the opposite is true for high-skill workers. Well, what will happen once the door to trade between the rich country and the emerging economy opens up? Well, now the rich country doesn't need to produce so much rice. It can shift production away from rice to software and import most of its rice from the emerging economy. And the emerging economy can do just the opposite. It can shift production away from software to rice and import its software from the rich country. So the emerging economy is now producing more rice, less software, than before, and this is good for low-skill workers because it raises the demand for low-skill workers. They are needed greatly for rice, not so much for software. This increased demand for low-skill workers raises the low-skill workers' wages. It also reduces the demand for high-skill workers. They're not needed for rice production, and so we see their wages fall. Low-skill wages are rising, high-skill wages are falling, and inequality is reduced. So what I've just given you now is the standard argument given by proponents of globalization for why globalization will reduce inequality in developing countries. And in fact, exactly this prediction has worked remarkably well historically. You should remember that this is not the first period of globalization that the world has seen. There have been other great periods of globalization. For example, there was a globalization in the second half of the 19th century involving Europe, which at that time had a relative abundance of low-skill labor, and the United States, which had a relative abundance of high-skill labor. Well, what happened in the late 19th century? There was a dramatic increase in trade between the US and Europe, which was made possible by a decline in shipping costs. It became possible to ship goods across the Atlantic much more cheaply than before. So there was a dramatic increase in trade. And just as the theory predicted, the theory of comparative advantage predicted, inequality fell in Europe. So the theory worked very well for this previous globalization, and it worked well for other globalizations. It has not worked so well for the recent globalization, and that suggests that there's something about the recent globalization which is different. By the way, the prediction that inequality should fall in developing countries is not the only prediction that comparative advantage got wrong. It also predicts that the more different two countries are from one another, that is, the bigger the difference in their labor forces, the more trade there should be, because the more gains from trade there will be between those two countries. Well, that is plainly not true in the current globalization. You have only to look at a very poor country like Malawi in Africa, and the fact that that Malawi does not trade very much with the US or with Europe, to see that that prediction does not hold up. But the prediction that I'm most interested in is this prediction about inequality. So, because the theory of comparative advantage doesn't work so well, I was led, in collaboration with Michael Kremer, who is a colleague of mine, a development economist at Harvard, to develop an alternative theory. And this shouldn't be thought so much as a substitute for theory of comparative advantage. We're not saying that the comparative advantage has to be replaced, but it has to be supplemented for the recent globalization. And let me spend the rest of my time on this alternative theory. The idea that we'd like to emphasize is that the current globalization has tended to create an internationalization of production as well as of consumption. So what do I mean by international production? Well, we've only to look at what's happening with computers to see what I mean by that. Computers might be designed in the US, programmed in Europe, and then assembled in China. So the production process itself takes place across international boundaries. And the reason why this is possible, of course, is that it's now very easy to coordinate with your production plants in China. Communication costs have fallen dramatically. So I'd like to put the emphasis on international production. For the purposes of this alternative theory, it's no longer enough to consider just two different skill levels. We have to consider many different skill levels. For my talk this morning, it'll suffice to look at four skill levels. So I want to do a similar kind of thought experiment to the one that I did when talking about the theory of comparative advantage. That is, I want to imagine that there's a rich country and a poor country. The rich country is rich, once again, because it has workers, a labor force with high skills. The skill levels that I'm going to be talking about are now going to be labeled A, B, C, and D. So there are four levels. A is the highest level, then B, then C, then D. The rich country has mostly workers of skill level A and B. The poor country has mostly workers of skill level C and D, and it's these skills which make the countries rich and poor. Now, we should think of the production process as consisting of different tasks. So what does a company do? It hires workers to fill certain jobs, fill certain tasks within the company. And to make matters simple, I'm going to suppose that there are two tasks. There's a managerial task, which is relatively sensitive to skill, so it matters a lot what the skill level of the person taking the managerial job has. And then there's a subordinate task, which is less sensitive to skill. The person taking that job, his skill doesn't matter so much. And output is produced by matching managers and subordinates together in a company by finding a manager, finding a subordinate to work together. And the amount of output that is produced will depend on the skill levels of the workers occupying those jobs. So this is actually the only little mathematical formula in the paper. It's a pretty simple one. The idea is that output is going to equal the square of the managerial skill level times the skill level of the subordinate. Now why is the manager's skill level squared? Well, it doesn't actually have to be a square, it could be a cube, it could be something else, but the point is that the power of two emphasizes that the output is particularly sensitive to the manager's skill. That's the point that this formula is getting across, that as we vary M, we're going to vary output more than as we vary S. So if M equals 4, S equals 3, output will be 4 squared, 4 times 4 times 3, for a total of 48. Now, there are different ways that workers could be matched. Let's look at a simple example. So, suppose that there was a labor force consisting of three workers. A three worker is a worker of skill level 3, and 2 4 workers, workers of skill level 4. One way they could be matched is this way. One of the four workers could be matched with one of the three workers. The other four worker could be matched with the other three worker. This is what we call cross-matching, because we have workers of different skill levels in the same firm. And if you do the computation, you'll see that this leads to a total output of 96. Another way that workers could be matched is four worker with the other four worker, the three worker with the other three worker. This is what we might call homogeneous matching, because within a firm, within a company, the two workers have the same skill level. But this leads to an total output of only 91. For this example, we're going to tend to see cross-matching, not homogeneous matching, because we get a higher output with cross-matching than with homogeneous matching. But that answer depends critically on the particular labor force that we have. If this labor force consists of 2 4 workers, 2 3 workers, if we change that labor force so that we now have 2 4 workers and 2 2 workers, the answer changes. Now it turns out that we get more outputs with homogeneous matching. And so we'll tend to see homogeneous matching in equilibrium. What point am I trying to get across with these two examples? There are two forces at work in deciding what kind of matches you get. Because the two tasks, the managerial task and the subordinate task, are differentially sensitive to skill, that's going to tend to push you toward cross-matching. You want to have higher skill workers in the managerial task, lower skill workers in the subordinate task. So that pushes you toward cross-matching. But there's another force at work. If the skill levels are too different, if a very highly skilled manager is matched with a very low-skilled subordinate, that's a waste of the high-skilled manager's skill. And so you don't want skill levels which are too different within a firm. That force is going to push you toward homogeneous matching, and the balance between cross-matching and homogeneous matching will be determined by the composition of the labor force. But those two forces will be exactly balanced in equilibrium. So what does this imply about our thought experiments in globalization? Well, let's go back to our two countries, the rich country and the poor country, and I want to compare matching patterns before globalization and after globalization. So this is the pattern that we're going to tend to get before international production becomes possible. So before globalization, all matching must be domestic. So in the rich country, we have to have matches which involve just workers in that country. And in the poor country, we have matches which involve just workers in that country. We're going to tend to see workers in the poor country match with B workers, and in the rich country we're going to tend to see A workers matched with B workers, cross-matching in both countries. Now what happens when the door to globalization opens, and so it becomes possible to have international production? Well, the matching pattern shifts, and we now see that the C workers from the poor country are matched with B workers in the rich country, and the D workers are now left to their own devices. They match with other D workers. Well, what effect does this change in international production have on inequality and on wages? And I should emphasize that the reason why the D workers are not matched with A or B workers is that the gap between their skill and the B workers' and A workers' skill is too big for it to be efficient for them to match with the A or B workers. So they're left to their own devices. So what happens to wages as a result of this shift in production? Well, before globalization, when the D workers were matched with the C workers, they had the benefits of the sea workers' higher skill level. You probably know from your own experience that if you're working with someone who is more skilled than you, that enhances your own productivity. It makes you work better than you would if you were left to your own devices. So pre-globalization, D workers had the benefit of working with C workers. Post-globalization, they no longer have this benefit. So D workers' wages are likely to either fall or at least not rise as a result of globalization. By contrast, the C workers now have this nice new job opportunity. They can work with B workers via the international company that is now employing them. So C workers have rising wages. And we see not a fall in inequality, but a rise in inequality in the developing country, which is just what has happened in countries like China and India. Inequality in the emerging economy is made worse as a result of globalization. Well, what can we do about this? Well, one thing that we might try to do is to stop globalization. This theory doesn't suggest that that's going to be a very good idea. For one thing, it's pretty hard to stop globalization, even if you wanted to. But in any case, globalization is not harming the developing country in total. It's very much helping the C workers. The main problem is that it's leaving the D workers out of the picture. So what we should try to do, if we can, is to give D workers some international matching opportunities too. And the way that we could do that is to raise their skill levels through education or job training to the point where they are part of the international labor force too. The problem, of course, is that such education and job training are expensive. Who is going to pay for it? The workers themselves are not going to be able to do so. They're too poor. The whole problem is that these are some of the most destitute workers in the world. They can't afford the education or job training needed to elevate their skill level. But the interesting point that I want to make is that we can't expect producers to have the incentive to do all of the job training needed either. And here's why. If you're an employer and I'm a D worker, and I come to you, you could train me, of course, but if you did train me, some of your investments would be lost to the fact that you now have to pay me a higher wage. Furthermore, once you've trained me, I can leave your company and go to work for your competitor, in which case you've lost your investment in me altogether. So this suggests that the market itself is not likely to solve the problem of inequality, because workers can't afford to upgrade their skills And employers don't have enough incentive to make that investment on their own. If we're going to do something about inequality, there has to be some investment by third parties. These third parties could be domestic governments or international agencies, foreign aid, even private foundations. But someone has to get into the act. And provide the funding for education. They don't necessarily have to provide the education themselves. They can do so indirectly by, for example, giving employers tax breaks if these employers are willing to train D workers. So the right course of action, at least according to the theory, is not to try to stop globalization, but to try to ensure that the benefits of globalization are shared more widely, to allow the low-skill workers, the D workers, to get something out of globalization, too. And with that moral, let me stop and thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Professor Maskey, for this very elegant theory on the connection between globalization and the increase of inequalities in developing countries. So the point is that there was too much of a gap, so that a fringe of workers was actually left alone by.
That's right.
By globalization, it was better for them to match localism, speak low skill with low skill, rather than being linked to the B workers.
The B workers would like very much to be linked with the B workers,
right.
but it's inefficient because the skill gap is too big.
Right.
So the way to address that problem is to raise the D workers up to the point where efficient matching with D workers or even A workers becomes feasible and desirable.
That's a terrific point. Now there is, of course, time for questions. Professor Maskey would very much like to have questions from the audience. Students are strongly invited to make questions, and we start with Professor Peter Crampton, who's European University Institute at the moment, but he's from University of Maryland in general. Okay, so thank you, Peter.
Thank you very much for your lecture. And I just wanted to...
Peter.
Oh, the mic closer, like this? Your example that you started with rang very true to me. My experience when I want to today hire programmers to build an auction platform, for example, I could go to Silicon Valley and spend $150,000 for ace programmers in Silicon Valley, or I can go to Shanghai and spend $40,000 for ace programmers that have, you know, they're definitely in the A category, and they're just much less expensive. So I go to Shanghai. And so it's just a perfect illustration of the software and the price. You know, now, in fact, the software is getting developed in China, in Russia, in India, just for this reason. So if you could perhaps just, well, I just want to say how much it rang true of perhaps the development.
Yes, one of the interesting feature. So we think of India as a developing country, if you look at its average income, it's still very low. But it's had this remarkable growth rates over the last 15, 20 years. Why? Precisely because it has a good education system, and they've been able to develop a spectacular biotech and IT industry by matching with educated, highly trained people abroad. If you go to Bangalore, and you see startup generic drug companies all over the place, that has been the driving force in Indian development, and the country has prospered as a result. But there are millions upon millions of people who have been left out of the picture altogether. People who can't work for a biotech startup. If something is to be done about them, if they're not simply to continue to languish, they have to get at least some level of education and training to allow for greater opportunities in their employment.
There's a theme,
though.
Yeah.
Yes, so I have a clarifying question, but in the second example, there is still the question on who's producing rice. So okay. if the demand for rice is unsatisfied, there seems to be an incentive for the B people in the rich country to go in the poor country and make efficient rice production. So maybe one problem is that there are barriers in the poor country to workers from the rich countries to go there and open rice producing firms, maybe.
Okay, I wonder whether it'd be possible to put the slides back again. Well, it's not a in the second model, the model that I've been developing with Michael Kramer. We don't actually distinguish between rice and computers any longer, because the emphasis is on the matching process. What is being produced through the matching process is no longer the focus of the theory. In the theory of comparative advantage, all the focus is on what is being produced and the shift in developing countries from software to rice. For the new theory, the good that's being produced, well, it doesn't really matter so much. In fact, everything I said could apply even if there was only a single good being produced. Because all we care about is who is doing the producing, who are the managers, who are the subordinates. So the new theory remains quite on the question of who is producing rice. That's why I say that this is an addition to comparative advantage theory, not a substitute for it. You can now bring in the theory of comparative advantage to say who will be doing the production. The two theories work together to give you the total picture.
Is there a question?
Yeah. No, just...
Oh, sorry. Okay, no, just a related, very related question, because, you know, you took a technology and it's the same technology all over the places, but actually in order to represent differences between countries, maybe you could figure out a technology which is unskilled biased and see what happens. So having heterogeneity in technology.
That's right.
What, complicates a lot, but.
Yes, well, in fact, in this alternative theory, the assumption is that the technology is the same everywhere. This M squared times S technology applies in every country. Of course, as you say, that technology transfer is not complete. And in fact, one problem in developing countries is that they might be using less efficient technology, in which case the conclusions of the theory are even stronger, because if you've got D workers who are producing according to an outmoded technology, and you've got C workers who get these international matching opportunities, the gap between their wages is likely to be even bigger when the D workers are not using up-to-date technology.
Hello. What is your opinion about the international trade between Mexico, Canada, and the United States? I mean, about the factor price of production.
Right. So there was a treaty developed 15, 20 years ago called the North American Free Trade Agreement, which actually considerably increased trade involving those three countries. And I think the evidence suggests that average GDP, average income in Mexico went up quite a lot as a result of that trade agreement. So on average, it was a good thing for Mexico. But then if you look at who got the benefits of that additional income, you see that they mainly went to white-collar workers. So NAFTA is actually a pretty good example of what has happened in recent times with globalization. Impressive improvements in developing countries overall, but unequal benefits, with the benefits going mainly to higher skill workers.
I think we could all acknowledge that, you know, as a species, we have the resources and the knowledge to solve this problem, but we just don't, you know. What was it that made you change your professional attention to this huge problem?
Well, it's a puzzle. Every economist is told about the theory of comparative advantage. It's one of the most interesting, secure, and successful theories we have. If you learn anything at all about international trade, you learn about trade between Portugal and England. That was how Ricardo described it. And you begin to believe that comparative advantage theory can explain everything. But then you run up against reality, and you see that, at least for this current localization, the theory doesn't work very well. And that conflict between reality and theory is a challenge, and it's fun to try to step up to a challenge and propose some kind of reconciliation. So it was mostly the intellectual challenge of trying to improve on this famous theory that got us going. Michael, my collaborator, is a development economist, and so he was already directly involved in the question of why inequality was going up in developing countries. But he roped me into it because I'm a theorist, and theorists should be able to say something about important questions. Going back to Frank Hahn, Frank strongly believed that theory is not just a game that you play for your own amusement, but that it should be able to tell you something important about the world.
More questions?
Excuse me. When you speak about A, B, C, D classes of a person, okay, you say that in the developed countries there are only C and D classes, while with the globalization, C workers join with B the workers in the developed countries. You are speaking about a simple translation from the lower classes to the middle classes of the C workers, while the D workers remain in the lower classes. So globalization is augmenting the speed of creation of a middle classes in the underdeveloped countries. And the D workers suffer because they are no more matched with the C workers, which could help them temporarily. But in a long time, D workers ought to grow better because because of the developing of the middle classes in their countries. So globalization are augmenting with this speed of growing of the middle class because of this A, B, C, D, and this transfer of C to matching with C with B workers instead of B workers instead of D workers.
Right.
Okay.
I agree with your analysis. That's right.
Globalization is, as a matter of fact, is a good one thing because it augments the speed of creation of middle class.
Oh, absolutely. I'm certainly not suggesting that we would want to stop globalization because of this theory. Quite the opposite. If you compute the overall gains to the developing country as a result of international production, they are positive. The emerging country benefits overall from globalization, no doubt. It's just that the poor D workers don't get much of that benefit, and so the question is how to get the D workers into the game too.
Thank you.
Dr. Laura Reynaldo from the University of Pittsburgh Medical Center, in fact.
So I just wanted to ask you if you could develop, going a bit further in your model, that what happens once the D workers and the C workers start to work together, their productivity increases. What does impede that group to fall back into a deposition or what are the influences of the speed through which technology can influence that segmentation of skills. So in some respect, is that a steady solution, right, or do you have, let's say, elaborated something that goes further, right, into the continuum of time and technologies grading?
So you raise some good points. What I showed you today is an extremely simple model. You might say that it's simplistic. It's oversimplified, and that's true. That there are two important features of a real economy that are left out here. First, I've left out time. If I were showing you a more realistic model, skills A, B, C, and D, skill levels would not be determined once and for all. They would be changing over time, and through the process of elevating yourself from a D worker to a C worker would be part of the model itself. What we would want to see in a dynamic model are the incentives for providing education and training to D workers or C workers. That's not in this model where skills are given exogenously. The other thing that is left out is technology. There's only this one technology. Output equals m squared times s. That technology is assumed to be fixed and unchanging, but of course, one important reality of modern life is that technology is always improving, right? Always changing. That too needs to be incorporated for a model like this to get closer to reality. But the reason I presented this version of the model rather than the more realistic one is because it's instructive, I think, to see how even in a very simple model we can begin to understand why inequality in developing countries has been rising. If we elaborate the model to make it more realistic, that's fine, but that's not going to alter the underlying message that inequality is going up because of different matching opportunities.
Further questions on the floor? Yes, Professor Score from Siena.
I think there is one actor, one player missing in your picture, the role of institutions. At the beginning of the Industrial Revolution, the condition of English workers was not so different from a condition of a worker in Bangladesh now. The English workers improved their conditions thanks to international trade, but also thanks to some political changes, some institutional changes, let's say union, minimum wages, the right to strike, something like that. So there was an important role of institution in, ruling the distributional conflict. In my opinion, one of the main reasons for the effect of globalization of inequality, both in developed and in emerging countries, is the fact that globalization is destroying or reducing the role of these institutional mechanisms. Do you agree with that? What's your opinion about it?
I agree in part. I don't want to deny the importance of institutions to the inequality story. As I've developed it, this is an institution-free model. The only institutions in this model are the firms themselves. But there's no government. There are no unions. That can either be thought of as a weakness, and you're suggesting that we've left out an important part of the story, or a strength. In answer to the previous question, I acknowledge that one thing that's left out of this story is capital. This model, as I've developed it, has only labor as an input. What happened to capital? What happened to land? What happened to oil? All of these omissions are important in the sense that in reality these things make a difference. Nevertheless, I think there's some strength to a simple model which abstracts from the complexities of reality and still gets the story more or less right. Perhaps it would be even more accurate if we brought these other factors back in, but when we can use a four-skill two-job model to go a remarkable way toward explaining modern inequality, I think that's a pretty good accomplishment already.
Question. Here's another question from a student.
You write that your work doesn't provide any vision of global inequality within the quality in the languages. Let's say the kid Danovich and I. Let's say that the case is that global inequality is decreasing. I don't know if that's actually the truth. Let's say Milanovic and others are right. Were it the case, how could your model relate to this phenomenon? Is it possible to have both rising inequalities within countries and declining global inequality?
The answer is yes. Even in this model, so here's a stylized fact that Tony Atkinson and others have emphasized. We have growing inequality in developing countries, as I've been talking about in this talk. We have growing inequality in rich countries, as we've been reading about in the newspaper. That was the big contribution of Piketty's work to publicize how unequal income has become in rich countries. And at the same time, we have a fall in global inequality. That is, the gap between average income in rich countries and average income in poor countries has been reduced. That's already here in this model. We have the gap between the A's and B's growing, the gap between the C's and D's growing, but the gap between the A's and B's on average and the C's and D's on average is falling. So once again, even in a simple model, we're able to capture some of the major inequality trends of our time.
Questions? Not that we didn't have questions so far. If there are more from the floor. There is a one. Faculty member.
Yes, I have a question about unemployment. Is it possible to introduce unemployment in this model? Because I think it is very important, especially because several developing countries have invested a lot in education, but then they end up with new generation, young generations without a job. So we have a problem that are not met. Because even if they have invested in human capital and in education, as your model tried to suggest it.
Yeah, the microphone.
Actually, we have quality and more ability. Because even if they have not, they have more human capital, they have not more employment.
Right. So why is it that so many young people have got some form of education and then are left unemployed? Well, again, if you accept a theory like this, it's because there isn't a good match between what they've learned and what skills are in demand. Just because you've been well educated doesn't necessarily mean you can offer very much to the global labor force. It may no longer be true that general education is enough, that what is really needed for employment is the acquisition of specific skills that global employers are demanding. But I should confess that I'm not a labor market specialist. I'm interested in the labor market because of this model, but I'm not the one to turn to for unemployment policy reforms.
More questions from the floor? Maybe the rector.
may have a question, and I may also have another question, and then perhaps we stop.
Very short. I mean, thank you for your elegant and very fascinating theory. What about the application of the theory to rich countries? I mean, because to a certain degree it can be applied, but why are you stressing that it's for emerging countries, or are you thinking of extending to rich countries?
Well, we've actually done both. And in fact, this kind of theory does apply to rich countries too, but the important difference is that developing countries like China and India have developed mainly because of globalization. If it weren't for global markets, the miracle in China would have been impossible. That's a development process which has relied critically on globalization. Growth in the in rich countries has not depended so crucially on globalization. The United States trades a fair amount, but most of its growth comes not from trade, which is on the order of 12%, but from domestic consumption and production. So yes, the theory can be adapted to apply to rich countries, and we have a separate paper that does that. But it's one that relies primarily on what's going on domestically rather than globally.
And if you allow me to, I can make a final remark or remark/question. So it seems like that in order to catch up, you need to push the deep people up. Okay, that's where education should focus its attention to. But it seems also like that in a dynamic perspective, the A people, paradoxically enough, should not move up also, because otherwise the relative distances would stay the same. So in order to avoid shifting the average, so to speak, but not the variance, there must be something there, so there's some kind of convergence between the bottom and the top. So I'm not saying that another policy recommendation would be to just make people less skillful at the top. But there is it may not be enough if people go up at the bottom and the top goes as up as the bottom, then the relative distances would remain the same, and that's one remark.
Well, that's right, and that gets back to a previous question about a dynamic model. We've taken the skills as given, but in a richer model, the skills would evolve over time through investment. And what you're suggesting is that it's not going to be very good for the D workers if their skills go up, if the other workers' skills go up even faster.
Even faster. Is it part of the frame? This kind of consideration in its dynamic perspective.
Absolutely. In a dynamic setting, you have to be sure that not only do D workers get more training, but they get sufficiently more training so that they're able to keep up with the other skill levels.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Right. And then I had another question that I think I can avoid making it. I think it's enough now. We would like to thank so much Professor Eric Maskin for having been here with us, and it's been a terrific opportunity for the whole community in San Francisco, for the whole university, and I would say for the whole town to have you here. So on behalf of everyone, thank you so much, and we would like to see you back soon. Thank you, Eric.